Our course is Fundamentals of Mechanical Engineering, Control Engineering, and my name is Wu, your family name is Wu. And last name is Yu. And you know, when I get to the airport, the safety check made a joke about my name. If you are you, who is me then? Nonsense. And I came from school for automobile and mechanical engineering. So here is some information about me. This is my email. You can send me emails if you have any questions, or contact me using QQ. And this is my office address, room 412, Engineering Building 1B. And here's are some details about the course. And this course, it's worth 2.5 credits. And in total, there are 40 hours and 34 in class, 16 in lab, but I will make some changes due to the course situation. And the performance assessments, I hope you can hand in me some assignment per chapter. Can you do that? Or just one problem in chapter, or no more than that. And attendance in class, for all of you who are in the school, okay, on the campus.
How about others that were outside?
I don't know how to judge them attendance. It's very difficult.
Yes, you know.
I will give for all of you a higher grade, maybe.
Thank you.
And experimental reports, if we can do the simulation experiments after the study. And the final exam in final week. I have not decided if we do the exam or do.
Daoxi, it will be better to assignment because those all the students, they are outside from China. So if all previous our subject or teachers, they all just give us final assignment, a good assignment. We just all solve these all problems.
So
and solve this assignment and then give to you. All teachers did this. That's why it will be better for everyone. And then according to our final assignment, you just include all the students' marks. Who is good with that? Like this.
So I will think about this.
Yes, it's no problem.
Okay. The textbook is this. You got this book?
Yeah.
And this is maybe you, there are any books named the 机械控制工程基础 or 控制工程基础, you can refer to.
I think about it.
Mechanical Engineering Control, or Fundamentals of Mechanical Control Engineering. And the control engineering basis. And here are some books you can refer to, and that one is our textbook. And you and me, pay attention, teacher and students in class, but we can be friends after class, okay? And here are some things, no work, no gain. No hard work, no happy end, no do, no die. Get the meaning of this sentence? And no big do, no bad die. So, here's some main contents of this course. First, chapter one, that's what we will study this class and this morning, introduction of the whole course. And chapter two is Laplace transform solution, math problems. Sorry. And chapter 3, formulation dynamic behavior of translational mechanic systems. Math problems again. And chapter 4, formulation dynamic behavior of electric systems. And chapter 5, fundamentals of control systems. And chapter 6, time response analysis of control systems. Chapter 7, frequency response analysis of control systems. And chapter 8, stability analysis of control systems. The last chapter, error analyzing calculation of control systems. So the chapters with the mark asterisks are core contents. So you should pay more attention to these chapters with the mark. So the main contents of this course. First, after study, everyone should be confident in the use of Laplace transform methods, next problem. An understanding of coupling yields response components, and familiarity with differential equations, mass problems, and transfer functions. And this is a very easy way to solve the mass problems for linear time environment systems. So most of the class, what the kind of system we're facing are linear time environments. It's kind of easier systems we're facing. And capability with block diagram manipulations and the use of maze and scan formula. And this is very important to build or to draw the block diagram for the control system. And familiarity with time response method, including first order system and second order system, especially performance specifications of second order system. No higher than second order, so we will not talk about higher than second order system. Experience and competence with frequency response, frequency characteristics, and its graphical methods. This is very important. Nyquist diagrams. Nyquist is a scientist who invented this kind of diagram method to analyzing the system. And Bode diagrams. Bode is also a name of a scientist who invented this kind of method to analyzing the system problems. Appreciation of performance specifications in the frequency domain and the relationship between performance indices in time domain and the specifications in frequency domain. So we are facing two domains problem. One is time domain, another is frequency domain. Thorough acquaintance with Rose-Hurwitz stability criteria. And this actually, guess, this name is for one person or two. Mm-hmm. Rose-Hurwitz.
One person.
No, it's for two. Because both of these two scientists who invent the stability criteria and the ways they invented are very similar. So people put this together to name the stability criteria. And the ability to find the relative stability. Appreciation of the feedback concept and its importance. Familiarity with steady state error concepts and calculation. And acquaintance with system susceptibility to disturbances. Familiarity with classical compensation methods and the real understanding of the principles guiding compensator design. Okay, let's start the chapter one. We can turn to page. I can't find the page here. Page one. You're not marking the page number. So this is the syllabus for the chapter one. So after I introduced some information about the course, the most word we use is system, right? We talk about system over and over. And so first, we must know what's the actual definition to define a system. Yeah. A system is any collection or interacting elements for which there are cause and effect relationships among the variables. So the most important feature of the definition is what? We take interactions among the variables into account in system modeling and analysis. So we can say a system is a combination of components or elements and is constructed to achieve an objective or multiple objectives. So a system is made to function to achieve an objective or multiple objectives. That's the target for a system function. So here is a typical type in systems. It's called dynamic systems. Dynamic system means variables, and in this kind of systems are time dependent. Variables. Not just talk about variables, but also the derivatives of one or more variables. So, in the process of analyzing a system, two tasks must be performed. First, I said before the class, modeling the system. What is modeling? It's to describe the system into a mathematical equations or formulas. So you describe the engineering problem into a math problem. That's the first step.
Modeling.
And after we modeling the system or we get the model of the system, we can solve the model. So that this is the second task or the second step. These two steps combined together is referred to as system analysis. So, modeling the system. Mathematical model. So, it is a description of a system in terms of equations. The basis of modeling a system. So if you want to build a model for the system or to do the modeling, we should obey some physical laws like conservation of energy or the Newton's laws. Right?
Yeah.
That system elements and their interconnections are known to obey. So we can write some equations due to this laws, right? So let's see an example. This is a very daily example because this is a automobile we can see all the time, right?
Yeah.
It's automobile is of course a dynamic system. And the conditions for the automobile to drive, we can drive it on a rough road. And if we talk about the dynamics about the automobile, masses, springs, shock absorbers are the key elements we should take into consideration, right?
Yeah.
And let's see, have you ever get the drive license?
No.
Yeah? If you get the driver license, you may be much familiar with the whole structure or the way to drive the car. So first is suspension systems. What is this? It's between the chassis and axles are designed to minimize the vertical motion of the chassis when the tires undergo a sudden change in motion because of the road surface, right?
Yeah.
And the tires, additional springs between wheels and rows. Driver, cushioned from the chassis motion by the characteristic of the seat damping and seat spring. And some frictions between the driver and the seat back. But we all know automobile is very complex if we want to do some analysis. So the complexity of system model is sometimes measured by the very important, by the number of independent energy storing elements. What is energy storing element? If we have learned the basis for the mechanical engineering, so we must know that spring, right? The spring can store the energy, right?
Yes, because energy is decompressed and decompressed.
Yeah, so this is a very typical energy storing elements. And for the automobile system, energy can be stored in four different masses. The masses can also store the energy. and in 5 different screens. We can see the figure and we can count that there are 4 different methods. First, of course, driver and the passengers and seats, right? The methods of the person and the seats. And the second is chassis. And third is front wheels and exhaust. And the fourth is rear wheels and axles. There are 4 different methods in the automobile system. And 5 different springs. What first one is between seat and the chassis. The second is between front chassis and the wheels. The third is between rear chassis and the wheels. And the fourth is the front tire, and the last one is the rear tire. Here are the 5 different springs in the automobile. We always want to make the engineering problem simple, right? Problem simple. We don't want to analyze a very complex problem. So sometimes we can, if the pinching effect is ignored, the analysis might be simplified by combining the front tires and the rear axles into a spring, into a single mass. So putting these two together as one. So the structure of the automobile can be simplified into a little simpler, easy structure. Independent energy storing elements. Energy can be stored in about 3 different masses and 3 different springs. Compared to the before the simplifications, there are 5 masses. 4 different masses and 5 different springs, but we do the simplification, so there are just 3 different masses and 3 different springs. So it's much easy. Solving the model. After we build the mass model for the object, so we can do the second step, solving the model. Solving the model is the process of using the mathematical model to determine certain features of the system's cause and effect. So the process equals analytical solution of simple models, or sometimes computer solution of more complex ones. Okay, we can not do the math problems just through our hand and paper, pencil and papers, and it's not easy. So we can look up to the computer solution. So, if the equation type of model is controlled by analytical methods you choose. Sometimes maybe we will build nonlinear differential equations. So that's if you see the name nonlinear. So it's very difficult to solve these kind of equations. So sometimes this kind of equation cannot be solved in a closed form, nearly closed form. And the solution of partial differential equations is better than the solution of ordinary differential equations. So sometimes, as I said before, using a computer to solve a complex model. But in some situation, however, if we use computer to solve kind of problems, maybe it has its limitation. So here are some remarks you should remember. If you want to be an engineer or do the job in the engineering field, you should remember the model being analyzed, it's only an approximate mathematical description of the system, nor the physical system itself. That is to say, there must be some kind of differences between the real problem and the model, right? Because we just describe the model, describe the engineering problem into a math model. But that does not mean they are totally equal, right? And the conclusions based on equations that require a variety of assumptions and simplifications in their development may or may not apply to the actual systems. If we have some difficulty in solving a math problem, we will make some assumptions or do some simplifications to make the problem easier to solve, right? But sometimes these kind of assumptions and simplifications may or may not apply to the actual system. And the more faithful a model is in describing the actual system, the more difficult it is to obtain general results. So these are two remarks you should remember if you want to be an engineer or do the jobs in the engineering field. So you can have some rest, right?
No.
A control object that everybody has. And the controller is cardinal scalar systems to adjust our temperature. But if you get a cold, have a fever, maybe this system won't function well, right? And this kind of system belongs to natural control systems and automatically controlled, right? And some big birds like hawks, and they can hover motionless in a very headwind, right? Hawk. And the controllers, hawk's feeders, and this also belongs to natural control systems automatically controlled. And this one, fishing objects on desk. We use our brain and our arm, hand, to fish something, and so we just adjust the distance and the distance from our hand and the objects we want to fish. So this is also belong to natural control systems automatically controlled. And talk about angle of car's front wheels. The controller is car steering system. A car usually is controlled by driver, by human. So it belongs to man-made control system. And it's not automatically controlled. It's manually controlled, right? But nowadays, there are very innovative technique called, auto drive, right?
Auto
drive. So auto drive compared to the drive by human. Auto drive is automatically controlled system. And the wheel speed, steam engine governor invented by Watt. So this kind of system belongs to man-made control system, but it is automatically controlled. So if we are facing the real object or the real engineering problem, we will think about how does an automatic control system work? We want to know how does this function. So here are two examples for you. The first one is manually controlled constant temperature cabinet. What is constant temperature cabinet? It's kind of a box, a cabinet. We want our target is to keep the temperature here in the cabinet in a relatively constant value. Keep the temperature at a very constant value. So this is our target. So here are some parts for the whole control system. The first one is the control object, constant temperature cabinet, right? The temperature in the cabinet, we want to make the temperature constant. And the measurement components is the thermometer. Through the thermometer, we can see what is actual temperature in the cabinet. And the actuator, there are three actuators in this system. First one is voltage regulator. So we regulate these parts to regulate the circuit and to have influence on the relative heater to change the heater's heat. heating degree, and therefore to change the temperature in the cabinet, right? This is come together, it's our adjusting or regulating part. And a gentleman here, it's also actuator, because the gentleman gets the temperature of the constant temperature cabinet from the thermometer. We need a man here to see from the thermometer to see what is the real temperature right now. And according to the thermometer, the gentleman gets the difference value and direction and makes a comparison with the desired temperature. So here a desired temperature, maybe let's see, make an assumption, maybe 15 degree. We want to make the temperature at 15. And now, if the gentleman gets the temperature from the thermometer, it's like 45, so not get to the 15. So, or maybe he gets the temperature higher than 50, or 55, or 60. So the men must, according to the difference value and the direction, the gentleman makes a control. If the actual temperature is higher than desired temperature, the gentleman adjusts the contactor of the voltage regulator to reduce the voltage, and the temperature of the cabinet comes lower, right? And the actual temperature comes to the desired temperature. This is the process. And if in the opposite way, according to the difference value and direction, the gentleman makes another control. If the actual temperature is lower than the desired temperature, this gentleman will adjust the contactor of the voltage regulator of the right to raise the voltage to make it higher, and the temperature of the cabinet becomes higher. So the actual temperature comes to desired temperature. So this is manually controlled constant temperature cabinet, because this system requires the gentleman to see the real temperature, and after see the difference between the desired temperature and the real temperature, this man must do the control to choose if she needs to raise the voltage or lower the voltage in order to let the real temperature comes to the desired temperature. So the process is well now. So we know how does this system work, right? So when the temperature in the cabinet comes to the desired temperature, the gentleman need not do anything to the contactor of the voltage regulator. They just let the temperature keep in the stable value. So the whole control process is over, right? Let's see another example. It's car engine speed automatic control process. Here is a car engine speed manual control process. It's before what? This kind of control process should be adjusted by a human to adjust the steam and to have influence on the bulb and to influence on the steam supply. So they will influence on steam engine to change the speed of the engine. This adjustment is made by human before bot. And bot invented a steam engine governor. It's it's automatically controlled. So this figure we see at the here are some parts in this steam governor. So the initial tension net, of which is the reference means the desired speed we want to get, determined by the desired speed, right? And this rotating bulbs is the engine speed is monitored by the lift of rotating bulbs working against a spring. So the bulbs is always rotating according to the action speed. And this steam bulb, as the rotating balls rise or fall, the valve will close or open close or open the steam control valve via mechanical linkage in such a sense as to compensate for the speed change. So the rotating ball speed may be slower or quickly, so they will make the valve be open or closed in a constant degree. So they will change the steam engine. So the steam engine will influence on the speed. So the motor speed, actual speed, if the actual speed is faster than desired speed, the centrifugal force of the rotating ball increases. So the rotating balls will rotate very fast. The steam valve moves up and becomes small. Steam supply becomes less. Motor speed becomes slow. So the motor speed will come to desired speed. So the difference between the motor speed or the actual speed and the desired speed is very important, because we will this system will adjust the speed according to the difference, right? And in this system, if the motor speed or actual speed is lower than the desired speed, the centrifugal force of the rotating balls decreases, so the balls were rotating not that fast, lower and lower. The steam valve moves down and becomes big, so the steam supply becomes more. Motor speed becomes fast, so motor speed comes to desired speed. When the car engine speed automatically control system travels with the desired speed, the steam will not go into either side of the hydrocylinder. So we say the speed meets the requirement. The process of car engine speed automatic control could be divided into three steps. First, read a speed indicator to observe the actual speed or motor speed. And second, have a desired speed. And third, get a speed arrow, or the difference between the motor speed and the desired speed. So if the arrow is bigger than zero, set the flow valve to increase the steam flow rates. The aim is to increase the actual speed. If the arrow is lower than zero, set the flow valve to decrease the system flow rate. The aim is to decrease the actual speed. So, difference between automatic control and manual control. What's the most important point? Comparing and setting are performed by the controller automatically for the formal. But in the manual control system, comparing and setting are performed by human. That's the difference. An important conclusion here. Automatic control process or equals to measuring errors of the control variables automatically and then correcting errors automatically. So the key points for an automatic control process or automatic control system is, first, we need to measure or to find out what the errors of the control variables and so the errors is between the actual value and the desired value, right? It's an error. And then after we find the error, we need to correct the errors. We want to eliminate the error. So what we want to we want to do for the target is the desired value equals the actual value. This is the whole process. So sometimes we can describe the system in language, right? But we can build a schematic block diagram like this to describe the system. It's more
it's much vivid. You can see it clearly right here. So a typical system, control system, usually have several parts here. First, it's feedback link. The feedback link is, what's the use of feedback link? It transforms the actual value back to the desired value and to make the difference, right? To measure the difference, measure the error here. So, in this car engine system, what is the feedback link? The rotating balls. The rotating balls, because we threw the rotating balls speed to determine whether we need to open the ball or close the ball. And another is actuator. Actuator here, in this instance, is steam engine, right? Amplification and the control of steam flow rate. What is this? What are these parts? The valve. The valve. The valve is a butterfly valve. And what is the control object here?
The control object.
The car engine speed regulating system is to.
Is to maintenance.
To change the speed of the wheels at last, right? So wheels is the controlled object. Which parts plays roles of comparison and amplification? Comparison is here to compare the desired value and actual value to make the error. Mechanical linkage. And in this system, what is the actual variable? I just talked about before. Actual speed of the steam engine, right? And the desired speed of the steam engine is the desired value. So this, all the parts together made the schematic diagram for the system. So here you can say we made a desired speed, and the desired speed is compared with the actual speed. So we get through the mechanical linkage, we get the error. So the error will influence on the butterfly valve to determine whether the steam engine is go faster or go slower. So the wheels will go faster or slow. So that is to say, to have influence on the actual speed. This is the whole process. So if we use schematic diagram, block diagram, the whole process of the control system is clearly demonstrated here. So let's summarize the structure of control systems. And here, we usually draw a circle and cross here to mean the summing point. And the summing point in the actual project, it's a comparative to get the difference between the actual value and desired value here. And the summing point is a descriptive symbol used in block diagrams to denote the algebraic summation of two or more signals. The direction of information flow is indicated by arrows and the algebraic nature of the summation by plus or minus signs. A feedback, or we can see a closed loop. Because if we don't have this feedback line, this whole diagram won't be a closed loop, right? Here is a closed loop. So a feedback or closed loop control system is a control system which tends to maintain or prescribe the relationship of one system variable to another by comparing functions or these variables and using the difference E error as a means of control here. And the controlled output variable C here is that quantity of condition of the control system, which is directly measured and controlled. That means to say it's the actual value. Actual value is the controlled output. And the reference input R is the signal established as a standard of comparison for a feedback control system. A constant value of R is also termed at set point. We set the value here. We set desired value or target value here. The primary feedback signal B here, it's a function of the control variable C, which is compared with the reference input R to obtain actual signal, accurating signal E here. The E is system error. It's the value that the ideal or desired value R minus the value of the automatically controlled variable B. So E equals R minus B. Disturbance. Sometimes the system is not that ideal, so we may have some disturbance or some noise to affect it on the control system. So a disturbance U, it's a signal other than R. It's not R, because we made the influence here directly on the control object. Other than R, which tends to affect the value of the controlled variable C. Here are the other main parts or terminologies in the schematic block diagram. So after this chapter, you should be able to build a schematic diagram for an actual system. Because first you know how does this work, and then draw this kind of picture to demonstrate its process. Here are the characteristics of the control system. Sometimes the system's response curve is like this shape. So this is, we made the desired value is 1, set as 1. And at the very first time, the response won't just get the 1 at very first time, because they must have some overshoot and then decrease and then get to the desired value 1 slowly. This is the typical shape of the response curve of a system. So here on this curve, there are some important points or some properties we need to take into consideration. First is MPT. MPT is the peak value, or the biggest value. Most of the time, the MPT happened during the overshoot, right? Overshoot. MPT is the peak value of the time response. And after a long time, and the response goes stable, and we can get the response final value. So we can compare the MPT peak value and the final value, and make the percentage overshoot PO here. To measure how many percentage that this MPT counting in the final value. And the settling time, TS, here. TS of a control system is the time to settle with a tolerance band either side of the desired value. Sometimes we want to get the desired value, but since there are some disturbance or noise or some difference, some difficulties, the final value won't get to the desired value very accurately. There may be so this should be a tolerance band here. So sometimes the tolerance band is the limitation is plus or minus by percentage, where the plus or minus, so we should have a tolerance band. If the response getting into this tolerance band, we can say it's get to the final value or it's stable. The swiftness of the response is measured by the rise time, TR, rise time, and the peak time, TP. Peak time, TP is easy to see from this figure. It's the biggest overshoot, the time when the biggest overshoot happened. So the time point is TP right here. And what is TR? Rise time TR is the time where response curve comes to the final value firstly. Here are the dynamic properties for the response curve for the control systems. So we should have some rest here. The teacher who are in charge of your course, but he or she doesn't speak very fluently English. That won't be a problem for you, or?
Oh,
yeah, my teacher. Who is my teacher? What's his name?
most of the teachers are not fluent, but we still can't.
Yes, go ahead, get we can see from the figure. If the difference between the controlled variables and the reference variable decays to zero, finally decays to zero, or the output converges to a limit, the system is said to be stable. And see the right hand side figure, unstable system. What is unstable system? It's otherwise the stable system. It is unstable system. Let's see the output. The value of the output becomes larger and larger, changes with time. The output value won't converges to a limit. So this figure shows unstable system. So let's see, think about this. A practical closed loop control system must be stable. Why?
Closed loop.
In a closed loop system, the actual value and the desired value it's compared to head and arrow. And as long as the control system is functioning, the arrow will be eliminated finally. So a practical closed loop control system must be stable. Eliminating instability is the first concern of the control system designer. So if we talk about to design a system or to analyze a system, stability is the first feature we need to think about. Accuracy. Here are three figures show three different systems. The left one is the steady arrow, this curve. When the time goes, this curve up, and the arrow between yt and xt will go infinity. And the middle feature, the steady state arrow, the arrow between yt and xt is equal to a constant r couple k. And the right side feature, steady state arrow between yt and xt is equal to zero. So, accuracy of those three systems, the right one, the right one, this one, zero, is the best among them. Because when we design a system or we control a system, we want to finally the steady state error, means the xt and yt, the error between these two variables, decays to zero. This is the best situation. Robustness. Let's see. Let's compare these two figures. Figure A, the feedback control system with some kind of disturbance here, input N, is disturbance. And figure B, different from figure A, introduce a feed forward here, feed forward control signal GC here, in order to reduce the steady state error by disturbance input N, right? Here, different C, here, there is a GC here, a feed forward control. So we can call among these two pictures, system of figure B has more robust than the system of figure A.
Elsie, oh, please. The previous slide, what is the importance of robust? To bring stability in the system?
Robustness means if the disturbance affects the whole system, if the system has more robust, means when the disturbance enlarge, they will affect the whole system less. If you have more robust in the system compared to system. Why is have more robust, why is have less? When the disturbance on these two systems enlarge, maybe the system who has less robust will goes to unstable.
Okay. But the first one?
The first one is disturbance here. If the disturbance is enlarged, and the influence of the XS and NS compared, maybe if the NS is large enough, the influence of the NS is bigger than XS. So this whole system may go unstable. But in this system, since we designed a feed forward here, so the error is no longer the YS minus XS, but we think the error that made by the NS here. So the whole control G1 is considered the error. Both are among NS, XS, and YS. So we take the NS into the whole closed loop. So when the NS enlarge, the whole closed control loop will eliminate the E. The E equals to eliminate the influence of NS here, because you made a second, a small control loop here. But this one doesn't have.
So it means this one will remain stable?
Compared to the this one. So we call the system of figure B has more robust than figure A. We talk about closed loop system. We can see there is a different type of control system from closed loop. Open loop control system. Here it's an example. You may use every day toaster, automatic toaster. Though it called automatic toaster, but you know, here's the button, right? You can switch the button to design, to set the desired toaster darkness setting or the timer, right? And the darkness knob or timer, the input quantity, the degree of darkness, right? To set the desired value. Here is the desired value. And the crispness of the toast produces the output quantity. That means the real value, output value, is the crispness of the toast that produce. If the crispness of bread is not satisfactory, this condition cannot automatically alter the length of time. because the time is settled when you switch the button. Since the output quantity has no influence on the input quantity, there is no feedback in this system. Understand? You just switch the button to decide what kind of degree of the darkness, how much will the toast be burned, right? And you set the desired toast darkness setting. But maybe after the time goes up, the Christmas doesn't meet your setting. But this whole process is finished. There is no closed loop to feedback the real crispiness back to the settled desired darkness to make the error and to change if the time should be goes longer or goes shorter, right? So this kind of system called an open loop control system. So toaster is a typical open loop control system. And here, elevator. Elevator is a control closed loop control system. Here is the typical schematical block diagram for control system, closed loop control system. Here is the control system of elevator. Let's make assumptions. Tommy. It's now at 10th floor, and he entered the elevator at this time, and he went to
floor.
He did the desired floor. He pushed the button 22nd floor. He wanted to go to 22nd floor, and then, but the elevator didn't go directly to 22nd floor. Quote. Another person, Zach, pressed the button at this time. He is now in 15th floor, and he also wants to go to the 22nd floor. So the elevator will stop first at the 10th floor to get Tommy in, right? And then, since the elevator goes to the 22nd floor, in the middle of the process, Zach pressed the button, so the elevator stopped at the 15th floor to let the Zach in, right?
Yes.
This is the whole press. So what is the desired value reference input at this time? At this time. Who chose the desired floor at this time? Tommy, right? Tommy, and the Tommy's desired floor is 22nd at this time.
Let's go to 10th floor.
And actual value at this time, what is the actual value? Tommy, at the 10th floor, right? Because at this time, the elevator is in the 10th floor to get Tommy in. So think about the schematic block diagram. So the B is 10th floor. The E arrow is 22nd minus 10, right? So it's 12 floors, right? The arrow. And this time, do we have disturbance here? This time. Do we have disturbance here? Disturbance means another person pressed the button. No, because this time only Tommy pressed the button, right? So here's no disturbance at this time, right? But when the time goes to this point, does the desired value change at this point of time? This time we should think about Zach, right? So Zach's desired value is also 22nd, right? This time. And for this point of time, what is the actual value?
15th
floor, because now that is in at this time, right? So what is the B for this time, think about the schematic diagram. What is the B? Floor. The real floor, the real number of the floor, right? 15. It's starting at 15th floor, actually. So 15 is the real number of the floor, right? 15th floor. And what is the arrow? We should do the desired value minus the actual value. So it's 7 floors. So at this time, disturbance means compared to the time Tommy pressed the button. This time, Zach pressed the button.
Mm-hmm.
So Zach's move becomes a disturbance for Tommy, right?
Yes.
So disturbance at this time is
four.
So that is a very typical closed loop control system, because we use elevator all the time, right?
Motion.
Hmm?
Oh, please. Is there any difference between the actual value and primary signal? This B, this sign.
B 和 E 是吗 ？B and E.
No. Actual value.
Actual value and desired value.
And B.
And B.
And B.
Let's see the diagram. This is actual value C here.
Mm-hmm.
And C transform to the summing point, right? To make the arrow E. And if the C is not, is before the sense of transforms, the value is still C. But if he goes through a sensor of transforms, the value may be changed. So it will be the value B. So that's the difference, C and B. B is the value that C goes through a sensor. Because you want to know to measure what's the real number of flow right now. But in this system, the transforms equals one. So in the elevator system, C equals B, because the sensors or transformers here equals 1. We can see as a numeric number 1 here. But in other systems, the sensors or transformers here may be different. Maybe another functions, maybe a multiple function or other functions, so the B will be different from C. Whether the C equals B or not depends on the form of sensor transformers in the feedback line. See here? Application of control theory in mechanical engineering systems. The first use of automatic control in Western civilization dated back to the period of 300 BC. In modern time, the theory of control is applied in many fields. First, the theory of control are employed by economists, medical personnel, financial experts, political scientists, biologists, and engineers. So they just say the theory of control are used in every field almost. Within the field of mechanical engineering, the heating system and the water heater in the house were the heating, ventilation, and air conditioning system. It's a modern building employed automatic control systems. This is the mechanical engineering use automatic control system in our daily life. And in aerospace, the control of aircrafts, helicopters, satellites, and missiles requires very sophisticated advanced control systems. And in ships, building industries, advanced control systems are often employed for steering and navigation. Navigation is a very big field for for using the control theorem.
Yeah.
Now, here is some history, a brief history of the control. A very early times, early control from 1400 BC to 1980. This is an ancient water clock of Western Han, from China. The dynasty is Western Han, about 200 BC. This system's purpose is keep the constant velocity of water drops to timing. This system's function is a little bit like today's clock. To timing
act. Constant velocity is just falling down water.
Yeah. So the constant velocity of time water drops to count the numbers and to count length of time.
Yeah.
Use this kind of system. And this is what we talked about before. Volta's flywheel governor. That is Volta's steam engine governor. And this is talk like the first engineering system that use automatic control theory. This is, and its purpose is control the steam value by flywheel governor in order to keep the constant velocity of the engine. The pre-classical period, very famous company, Ford Motor Company, right? And from 1900 and 1935, automated components assembly lines, this is very important. What are these kind of things, assembly lines, are still used in many countries and industries now, right? Assembly lines, automatically assembly.
Yeah.
And its feature, adopted conveyor belt during producing process, changed from island production mode, island, isolated from other parts. Every process is isolated from one another. But they change this kind of mode into automated components assembly lines one by one. So the efficiency is much increased by the automated components assembly lines. This kind of ways are still used nowadays. And the classical control. This scientist named Norbert Wiener. He wrote a book named Cybernetics. In this book, every history first give the definition of feedback control. He wrote in the back, founder of Cybernetics, Norbert Wiener, he said, feedback is a method of controlling a system by inserting into it the result of its past performance. That is the same as we say the desired value and the set value, as a desired value and the real value, output value, right? This is but he is the first person to give the definition of the feedback. So this is the typical closed loop feedback control system. Actually, the control engineering, it's a branch of cybernetics. What we are talking about, what we are teaching and studying in this class, it's a branch of cybernetics. And the modern control from 1950. You see the Soviet Union. That is the time when Soviet Union and US began the space race. So space race is make the development of modern control very quickly during that time, during space race. Apollo. This is still a controversial topic, whether the US is getting into the moon or not.
Yes, yes.
You believe it's really getting there or just a lie? So it's still a controversial topic nowadays.
But I have a question. Why don't next time try to go more?
Space race.
Yes.
They want to
like second times. If you can go there,
maybe it costs a lot. Don't know. So it's a controversial topic because no one can get the right answer. And nowadays, it's the Mars exploration Uber Spirit.
Yeah.
This is nowadays. So let's do some exercise to make the some of today's open loop system and a closed loop system with the same precession components. Suppose they have the same precession components. Which type of system has much higher currency? Think about the toaster
plus
and the elevator.
Yes, plus system.
Which one?
Plus system stuff.
Be confident in your answer.
Closed loop.
think about the toaster. If you buy a very cheap toaster, most of the time you get your bread burned. Right?
Yeah.
So think about that. So you will choose closed loop. And let's see the second question. Which type of system's out signal has an impact on the control function? Be confident in your answer. Give me an answer, whatever.
Closed?
Yeah, closed loop. Because closed loop, another name of closed loop system is feedback. So the feedback means the output signal is feedback to the desired value. They made an arrow there at the starting point, right? But the closed loop doesn't have closed loop the feedback. So the output signal will not have the impact on the control function, right? And question three, which type of system is more resistant to interference?
More resistant.
Awesome.
They don't have the feedbacks. So they will do nothing to the interference in the open loop system, right? But the closed loop system can have feedbacks. So it has more resistance to interference. So what is the prerequisite to ensure the normal operation of the control system? Think about the system. The system have lots of ability, like quickness, they will respond quickly, or the accuracy. Finally, they can get to the desired value very accurately. And continue. This would be the wrong answer. I think I never talked about this, right? And you can choose from
accuracy.
What is the prerequisite to ensure?
Stability.
The normal operation.
Oh, accuracy.
Really? Accuracy? Normal operation.
Stability.
Means general operation. What kind of ability to ensure this system can function in, not where, just can be functioned?
Stability.
If the system is not stable,
yeah.
We cannot talk about quickness or accuracy because it's not stable at all. So if the system is not stable at first, there's no need to talk about the quickness or accuracy, right? Because this system is not stable, so means this system cannot be controlled.
Yeah.
If a system cannot be controlled, how can we talk about the quickness for occurrence? No need to talk about the other abilities of the system. So when some problems need to compare the open loop system and closed loop system, think about the toaster. Think about the raw bread ever burned. Think about the toaster, and you can have the comparison between open loop system and closed loop system. That's all for chapter one. And here assignment.
No, the class group.
But we still got time, right?
Yeah.
Let's turn to page 17. Let's see the assignment here. We can have a discussion about this, so you can finish your assignment easily. Let's discuss about the figure 1.12, water level control system. Think about how does this work. So let's see, here is a boil to measure the level. The boil is a ball floating on the surface of the water, right? And let's see, here is a valve, means valve 2. What's the use of valve 2 here? We have two valves here, right? One is valve 1, another is valve 2. Valve 1 is to fill the water in. Valve 2, what is the... Yeah, that is an outlet valve. It's work to prevent water tank overflow. Right? We need to let the rest of the water to flow out. So otherwise the tank will be overflow. Yeah. This is the use of valve 2. Okay, let's see the valve 1. The bold one is
filling water.
Yeah, it's filling water. And the bold one, what control the bold one? What elements control the bold one?
The boil.
When the boil goes up, and the bold one will be closed or open.
Close.
That means when the water's level goes up,
it's closed.
The bold one is finally closed to let the water value get to the desired value. But if the boil is going up, that makes the water level is not reaching the desired value, it's lower. So this boil will make the bold one open up.
Yeah.
And the bold one will get the water in. And when the water gets in, the boil will go up to the desired value.
Yes.
So this is the whole process of this water level control system. So you guys got that?
Yeah.
That will be easy for you to finish the problem 1.4. Right? 1.4 is explain the principle of the water level control system. So Daniel gets the point, the boil is very important.
Yes, boils.
Yeah, I
also mean this one.
What you're talking about is right too, but you need to tell more details through the according to the figure. Because the figure gives you the boil, so you should talk about the boil.
I never say the boil. I just thinking we have a system like this.
The principle.
Yeah, this one. And
it's the same.
Yeah, you can tell the motor. Is it stop or up? Mm-hmm. Up water and stop or no? I understand.
So the boil is 300 weights.
Huh?
300 weights. Says at least 300 weights.
300 watts.
No, for the question.
5.5. Build a schematic block diagram for the system. Sure.
No,
1.4. It says
at least 300 words.
You can
describe it in less words.
In
it's
less,
okay if you can describe it clearly.
Okay.
Let me understand. Okay.
Okay, is the handwriting or box five?
So you do the homework 1.4 and you draw the picture. You build a schematic block diagram. So that is the task list left to you to do after class. Okay, I want to talk about this on class.
Okay.
You can try to make pictures of the schematic diagram. It's okay. You can make mistakes. That's okay. That's fine. I will practice for you.
Alright.
Okay.
Thank you.
So we still have time. When will you get over your class? Oh, get finished your class.
That is depends on teachers.
Depends on you.
It depends on you.
I think it's a little earlier to finish the class.
Not only some teachers are finished before 1 hour. So this TV can.